Hello and welcome to worship, Lord of Life, Gethsemane Lutheran, and all who are worshiping here today. We are here for Holy Saturday, which is the third part in a one worship experience. It began on Maundy Thursday, continued on Good Friday, and now it is the service of watching and waiting. If you've worshiped with Lord of Life before, on the Saturday before Easter, it probably felt a lot like an Easter morning service. But this one is going to be a little bit different. We are in that in-between time from Jesus' crucifixion and death and before his resurrection moment. So take tonight to watch and wait and reflect on what Christ being our light is all about. At the end of our service, we are going to have an affirmation of baptism. And so I invite you to find a bowl or a cup of water to get ready for that part of the service. And as we begin, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Christ, yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, you promised to light the way into everlasting life. Yet here we sit, in the silence between what is already and what is not yet. Call us into these hours to consider how far you, dear God, will go to display your love for us.
This is the night when you brought our fathers and mothers, the children of Israel, out of bondage in Egypt and led them through the Red Sea on dry ground.
This is the night when all who believe in Christ are delivered from bondage to sin and are restored to the life and immortality.
This is the night when Christ, the life, rose from the dead. The seal of the grave is broken, and the morning of a new creation breaks forth out of night. How wonderful and beyond all telling is your mercy towards us, O God, that you would go to the depths and that they would not overcome.
How holy is this night when we keep time and wait. We pause in the tragedy and we seek God's presence.
How holy is this night when innocence is restored to the fallen and joy is given to those downcast.
How blessed is this night when we are reconciled to God in Christ. Rejoice now, all you heavenly choirs of angels. Rejoice now, all creation. Sound forth, trumpet of salvation, and proclaim the triumph of our King.
Rejoice to all the earth in the radiance of the light now poured upon you and made brilliant by the brightness of the everlasting King. Know that the ancient shadows have been banished forever. Rejoice, O Church of Christ, clothed in the brightness of this light. Let all this house of God ring out with rejoicing, with the praises of all God's faithful people.
Holy One, accept now this night of thanksgiving and praise. Let Christ, the true light and morning star, shine in our hearts. He who gives light to all creation, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Christ be our light. Today's the day we call Holy Saturday. It's the day in between Good Friday and Easter. It recalls the one day in the last 2,000 years when literally no one in the world thought Jesus was alive. I don't particularly like this in-between day. You know, I just kind of want to get on with it. I want to leapfrog right over Saturday and get to the excitement and the joy of Easter. I never know how I'm supposed to feel on Holy Saturday. Is it okay to go out to eat or check the movie listings or play golf? What do we do on this in-between day? A word that I've been reading and hearing a lot in the past year is the word liminal. I've experienced it so often that I decided I might as well learn what it means. Liminal, it turns out, means threshold. Liminal is a threshold space between what was and what is yet to come. It is an in-between time, and it's a regular occurrence in our lives. It's when you've left one job, but you haven't started the next. It's when you move from one town to another. It happens when you get married or get divorced or have a child or become an empty nester. Well, whatever the change, a liminal time represents a seismic shift. And you find yourself on a threshold between what was and what will be. And it's usually a little bit uncomfortable. Holy Saturday is a liminal day. Jesus' body has been taken down from the cross. It was wrapped in cloths and laid in a tomb. The door of the tomb has been covered by a great stone. And then the Bible goes silent. The 2 days on either side of Holy Saturday are maybe the two most studied days in history. The Bible is full of what happened the day before, the day Jesus was killed. And for the next day, Sunday, we are given a detailed recounting of the resurrection in all four Gospels. But all the Bible tells us about the 36 hours between sundown on Good Friday and sunrise on Easter is that guards were placed in front of the tomb. That's all we know. This isn't Friday, this isn't Sunday, this is Saturday, the day after the crucifixion, but the day before the resurrection. It's a liminal day in between darkness and light, in between despair and joy. in between confusion and clarity. We are actually living in a liminal time ourselves. The coronavirus has killed millions around the world and over 560,000 Americans. It has completely disrupted all aspects of our lives. But the vaccine is now here. There's hope, but the virus is still far from under control. We are in a liminal space. Now, next week, Lord of Life will be back together for in-person worship. But the choir will not yet be singing their alleluias, and there's not going to be any donuts. We are in between. It is a liminal space. The Chauvin trial finally is underway, but it's not yet complete. We're in between. It's a liminal time. And there are a score of families here at Lord of Life who've had a loved one die during the pandemic, but a funeral was never held. They are in a liminal space. And when you are in a liminal space, you often get frustrated. The Israelites had been miraculously delivered from slavery in Egypt, and there was a promised land in their future. But for now, they were stuck in the wilderness. It was a liminal time. They were discouraged, and in fact, they complained bitterly. They even threatened to go back to slavery because at least there they had enough to eat. They didn't like the in-between time. But God hears their cries and provides everything they need to survive their time in the wilderness. And after a long wait, they stepped over the threshold into the promised land. Liminal time is a time of waiting, and waiting can be frustrating. Standing on the threshold, the easiest thing to do is to turn back to the familiar, the comfortable, to what feels safe, secure. But eventually, that tendency to hold on to the familiar becomes a barrier to stepping across the threshold and discovering the hope and promise and possibilities of how God is working to transform our lives. Liminal time, thus, is a wonderful time to learn. And it has me asking these questions. What have we learned during the pandemic? What has it taught us about what gives our lives meaning and purpose? What's important to us? And how can we prevent ourselves from going back to the old and instead be transformed to something new? And what have we learned from George Floyd? What has it taught us about racism in our culture? And how can we now prevent ourselves from going back, instead be transformed into something new? And what have we learned as a church from being away from this building for over a year now? What does it tell us about what we value in our church? What's most essential to us? And how might we allow that to transform us to something new? On Holy Saturday, Jesus, the Son of God, lay dead on a slab in a tomb. No one thought he was alive. But it turned out that Jesus' followers were standing on the threshold of a new and transformed life. What can we learn from that? Well, we won't learn all of what that means in a thousand Holy Saturdays. But I think it does teach us Christians that as we stand on the threshold between what was and what will be, the wisest thing that we can do is to wait, watch, listen, and pray. Be still. Be aware. Be patient. Be hopeful. Most importantly, be open to the transformative power of God. For like those who live through the first Holy Saturday, you never know what the morning will bring.
Tonight we tell the story of God's redeeming love through stories from Scripture from ages past. God delivers the people out of fear, grief, oppression, and leads them into life everlasting. In these moments where the days feel short and the minutes long, get comfortable. Breathe deep and listen with an open heart. In this time before Jesus' resurrection, we wait. We sit still, we sigh deep, and we know that the next step is possible, but it's not quite there yet.
As Pharaoh drew near, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us alone and let us serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." But Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward, but you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground." Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. When I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots and his chariots drivers. The angel of the Lord who was going before the Israelite army moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and drew the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the shore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Then the prophet Miriam, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women went out after her with tambourines and with dancing. And Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he's thrown into the sea."
Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it.
King Nebuchadnezzar made a golden statue 90 feet high and whose width was 9 feet 9 inches. He set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then King Nebuchadnezzar sent for the satraps, the prefects, and the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to assemble and come to the dedication of the statue that he had set up. So they all came. When they were standing before the statue that Nebuchadnezzar had set up, the herald proclaimed aloud, "You are commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, drum, and entire musical ensemble, you are to fall down and worship the golden statue that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship shall immediately be thrown into a furnace of blazing fire." Therefore, as soon as all the people heard the sound of the entire ensemble, the peoples, nations, and languages fell down and worshiped the golden statue that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Accordingly, at this time, certain Chaldeans came forward and denounced the Judeans. They said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the entire musical ensemble shall fall down and worship the golden statue, and whoever does not fall down and worship shall be thrown into a furnace of blazing fire. There are certain Judeans whom you have appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These pay no heed to you, O king. They do not serve your God, and they do not worship the golden statue that you have set up." Then King Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded that they be brought in. So they brought these young men before the king. He said to them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods, and you do not worship the golden statue that I've set up? Now, if you are ready, when you hear the sound of the entire musical ensemble, to fall down and worship the statue that I've made, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be thrown into a furnace of blazing fire. And who is the God that will deliver you out of my hands?" The three men answer the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to present a defense to you in this matter. If our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the furnace of blazing fire and out of your hand, O king, let him deliver us. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods and we will not worship the golden statue that you have set up." Then King Nebuchadnezzar was so filled with rage against them that his face was distorted. He ordered the furnace heated up 7 times more than was customary and ordered some of the strongest guards in his army to bind them and to throw them into the furnace of blazing fire. So the men were bound, still wearing their tunics, their trousers, their hats, and their other garments, and they were thrown into the furnace of blazing fire. Because the king's command was urgent and the furnace was so overheated, the raging flames killed the men who lifted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But the three men fell down, bound, into the furnace of blazing fire. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up quickly. He said to his counselors, "Was it not three men that we threw bound into the fire?" They answered the king, "True, O king." He replied, "But I see four men unbound walking in the middle of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the fourth has the appearance of a god." Nebuchadnezzar then approached the door of the furnace of blazing fire and said, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out. Come here." So they came out from the fire. And the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the king counselors gathered together and saw that the fire had not had any power over the bodies of those men. The hair of their heads was not singed, their tunics were not harmed, and not even the smell of fire came from them. Nebuchadnezzar said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. They disobeyed the king's command and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree, any people, nation, or language that utters blasphemy against the God of these young men shall be torn from limb to limb, and their houses laid in ruins. For there is no other God who is able to deliver in this way."
Within our darkest night, you kindle the fire that never dies.
On this most holy night, we pray that God renew the world with the joy of new life and for God's mercy to endure forever. Christ, our guiding star, teach us how to wait, how to sit in the liminality of the moment, how to experience your presence in the most unlikely of circumstances. Grant us your life, O God of light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the earth, this country, this city and state, and this community. Repair all that has been harmed and allow us to see the treasures that you provide, whether it is in the land, water, air, or the interactions between us. Remove divisions that separate and help us to be stewards and caretakers of the gifts that you give. Grant us your life, O God, our Maker. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who do not know who they are or where they are going. Offer space for thoughtful and safe reflection. Uplift mental health professionals, life coaches, and all who tend to needs around identity. Remind us that our belovedness is a deep well that comes from the expansiveness of your love. Grant us your life, O God, our refuge. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who suffer from COVID-19, that the pandemic will abate and that human societies will be restored to health and safety. We mourn with the family and friends of over 2,800,000 worldwide lives that have been lost, with over 550,000 of them happening here in the United States of America. Enfold them all in your comfort and peace, and empower us all to make decisions that prevent this virus from spreading even further. grant us your life, O God, our stronghold and our song. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who tend to the sick, that they may find remedies for the distress and help restore fullness of life to those they care for. Bless doctors, nurses, lab technicians, orderlies, supporting care staff, and so much more. In these days where receiving medical care can feel daunting or lonely, work through the hands and feet of those called to care. Grant us your life, O God, our strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You who stand with us in the fire, grant us your life. We commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one with whom we have been raised to new life, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 16th chapter. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Joyous light of heavenly glory, loving glow of God's own face, you who sleep creation's story, shine on every land and race. Now as evening falls around us, we shall raise our songs to you, God of day. Chains asunder, set us free and made.
The stone has been rolled away, and we live in these moments between Christ's life, death, and resurrection. Through baptism, we acknowledge that we die with him and are raised to new life through him. You are invited now to make a public profession of your faith, and we encourage you to find some water to touch and feel these promises. Please feel free to press pause if you need to gather these items now.
In the earliest days of the Christian church, all of the baptisms for the entire year took place on Holy Saturday. So tonight, as we remember that fact, I ask you to reaffirm your baptismal vows by answering these questions. Do you, my friends in Christ, intend to continue in the promise God made with you in holy baptism? To live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. If so, please say, I do. And I ask God to help and guide me.
And as people of God, do you promise to support and pray for one another in your life in Christ? If so, please say, I do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
And now, just as it happened on your baptismal day, I invite you to mark yourself with water in the sign of the cross on your forehead. And hear these words. Dear child of God, remember that you are named and claimed by the God who would go to the ends of the earth for you, and that you are marked with the cross of Christ forever.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. Stir up in your people the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Reminded of God's promises as you nestle in before Easter morning, may the alleluias echo in your ears. May forgiveness lodge in your heart. May holy light guide your path. May God bless your coming and your going. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia.